we are, born to be kings. We're the princes of the universe. Here we belong. Fighting to survive in a war with the darkest power.
Hi, folks, and welcome to another Princes of the Universe. I'm Matt.
And I'm Bruce.
And let's get started. We're going to start with a question we got a few weeks ago. It was from John Hansen. He says, have we read any novels based off the games, video games, any video games? Mass Effect, Halo, Bruce?
I read the very first Mortal Kombat novel way back in the 90s, and I really enjoyed it. And I've read some of the first Halo books, but it really wasn't my thing, so I kind of dropped it. And what else have I read game-wise? That might be it.
I'm the same way. I read the first two Halo novels, and I liked them both. The Star Wars Expanded Universe kind of took over my interest. It was going on heavy at the same time of those books, and Halo just kind of fell to the side. I didn't think they were bad.
No, they weren't bad.
I just had other things I wanted to read.
And I've been tempted to go back and pick them back up, but, you know, I never played the game Halo. I just was, you know, so I had some friends that read them and they really enjoyed them and pushed on me as good stories. I thought they were fine. But, you know, they didn't hold my attention, didn't grab, you know, if I run out of other things that I'm really interested in, I'll probably go back into them one day.
Now, John also this week said that his favorite actor in the movies would be Christopher Lee.
Not a bad choice.
No, not a bad choice at all, considering he was like 80
yeah.
when the movie was being made.
And he brings a lot of gravitas to any role he does.
Oh, he does. He goes all. He didn't look tired like Bruce Willis does in every movie now. The Christopher Lee looks like he could go another 7 rounds on another movie there. He's so fantastic.
But he only had the one movie, and that's really one reason why he wasn't in the running for us.
Basically, that's the reason. Is he a great actor in Attack of the Clones? Yes. He's the perfect villain. I would agree. Unfortunately, episode 3 didn't really showcase him that much. But no, he is a great actor.
He was on set for like 5 minutes for that movie.
Yeah. All right. So anyway, next question. Questions from this week. Black Jedi asks about the top 5 DC characters. Now, that's a great question because we are going to answer that one. We're going to devote one whole episode to comic books later. But we can go ahead and do that. But we're going to go ahead and just nip this in the bud because people are going to ask us, what's your top fave Marvel? So we're going to go ahead and do Marvel first. Mm. Now, Bruce is going to give number 5 and number 4. I'm going to give my number 2, since I only have 2. Bruce is going to give his number 3 and number 2. Then I'll give my number 1. Then you give your number 1. Okay?
Okay.
All right. So what is number 5 for you?
Spider-Man.
Number 5 is Spider-Man. Yes. Okay. Number 4.
Number 4. See, 4 was a tough one for me to choose. I'm going to go with Green Hulk.
Green Hulk?
Yes.
Oh, no. I have a bad feeling about this. Okay, so my number 2, Gambit.
Gambit.
Of course I'm going to pick someone from Louisiana. But I always thought Gambit was fun as an X-Men. I mean,
He was funner in the 90s. I think they barely used him in the 2000s.
Yeah, they barely. Why was that?
I have no earthly idea.
They didn't really overuse him in the 90s, did they? They gave him his own comic book for a very short time, but
The popularity, I don't know if it fell off or what, but he spiked and then just kind of faded away.
To me, he was way more interesting than Wolverine. And I love Wolverine, but just Gambit was fun. I collected Gambit comic cards back in the day. I still have a whole case full of them somewhere. All right, so what is number 3?
3, Gray Hulk.
Are there any other colors before I go any further?
We'll get there.
Oh, no. Okay, so what is number 2?
2, I would say, is Savage Hulk. Now, when he completely lost his mind, Banner was separated from him. That was
I already know who your number 1 is. You've done process of elimination for me. My number 1, of course, is Bruce's number 5 at Spider-Man. It's really the only Marvel comic book. I got a few X-Men, but basically, it's the only comic book I collected for a while. So Spider-Man would be my number 1. And who is your number 1?
I'm going to go with Banner Hulk from the Dale Keown and Peter David run. Love those books.
I knew it was going to be Peter David. It was going to be that or the Maestro. Because I thought Maestro didn't get in the top five.
He's number six.
Bruce is a big Hulk smash fan.
Yes, I am.
Huge Hulk fan.
If you ever ask me in a fight who would win between X and the Hulk, the answer is always Hulk. I don't care who it is.
Okay, that's good. Now we're going to have people asking you Thanos with the Infinity Gauntlet versus Hulk.
They're doing a combo right now.
No, they're not.
Well, he doesn't have the Infinity Gauntlet, but the Hulk did face him with the Infinity Gauntlet, and I thought he was cheated with some poor writing.
Wow. Okay, so let's go into our top five DC characters.
Okay.
Bruce, give me number five.
Okay, this is any character that's appeared in DC comic books.
Yeah, any character.
Okay, Banner Hulk from the Marvel vs. DC, printed by DC Comics. Does that count?
I have a super bad feeling about this top five. Give me number four. Just go ahead and give me your top five.
Green Hulk from Batman. No, it was, yeah, Batman versus Hulk back in the 70s.
Right. Who won that battle?
The Hulk did.
Batman did.
There were several pages after the end that got cut. They were on the opening room floor, but the Hulk came back.
They answered that question. Who would win a fight between Batman and Hulk? Batman. Okay, so number three for you. This is a farce.
I know. I'm going to go here. I'm going to go with the Red Sun Superman. I thought that was a fantastic storyline. I like the whole idea of the communist Superman.
Wow, okay. Okay, that was an interesting story. Seeing as Superman...
Really, I will also say, let's just say parallel Superman. I'm going to go with Kingdom Come Superman, put it on the same level. I love both of those versions of Superman.
Yeah, because the real Superman sucks. All right, so what's your number three?
He-Man. The first He-Man comic books from the 80s by DC Comic Books, and DC Comics is currently publishing a new run of He-Man comic books.
There are going to be so many people pissed off at you.
Hey, He-Man and Superman are in the same universe. They fought in the pre-Crisis era, and they've fought recently in the DC Universe versus the Master Universe.
Oh, jeez.
So, hey. It's all there.
Thundar the Barbarian versus He-Man. Who wins?
He-Man.
He-Man versus Hulk?
Tie. They would fight. They would sit back and
Oh, whatever. Prince Adam versus Hulk. Prince Adam versus Bruce Banner. There you go. All right.
Number one's
going
to be Batman. Love me some Batman.
This is ridiculous. Why would we even ask this question? Anyway, my number five is going to be Flash. It's going to be Barry Allen Flash, which I heard they brought him back.
What do you mean? Oh, in the comic books?
Yeah, that's a shame. No one ever stays dead.
No.
But Barry Allen Flash.
Hey, Gwen Stacy's kind of sort of back in Marvel Comics.
Anyway.
The only one they haven't brought back is Uncle Ben.
Yet. Anyway, so number four be Green Lantern, and it's going to be the Hal Jordan Green Lantern.
Mm-hmm.
Even though I like Kyle Rayner, and as I thought he was a good replacement, I know some people didn't, but I did like him. But Hal Jordan, and I actually collected a Green Lantern for a while. Number three would be Robin. That would be the Tim Drake Robin as my favorite Robin. Number two is of course Nightwing. I think Dick Grayson is such a interesting character. And just proves to be more and more interesting, even without his interactions with Bruce. Even though I gotta admit, whenever he and Batman team up, you know, it's like the old days again. It's so good seeing them work together. He trusts Dick Grayson more than other people.
And he really is the first superhero to kind of grow up.
Exactly.
I can't think of anybody from before that.
All of them have earned Bruce's respect in some way or fashion, but he trusts Dick Grayson completely.
Yes.
Anyway, and of course, number one, obviously, Batman. I mean, come on, who am I kidding here? I've picked most of the Bat crew here. I kind of wanted to put Batgirl in there, but no, I do like Hal Jordan a little bit better. The only one if I could put honorable mention would be Firestorm. I don't know why. I just liked him as a kid.
I liked him as a kid in the Superpowers cartoon series.
That's why I liked him. He was in the Superpowers and he was just like a regular kid with a professor in his head.
And he's currently on The Flash on WB.
Have you caught up yet?
No.
Okay, then don't plug it. Okay, next question. Mod 6, ask, do you guys ever listen to Star Wars audiobooks? Bruce, Do you ever listen to audiobooks?
Today, no, but yes, I am. I'm working on a collection of all of them. I love the Star Wars audiobooks. I like the way that they integrate the music and the special effects,
the sounds.
Yes, and it makes the whole reading a lot much more fun.
Yeah, it makes it much more enjoyable. And to be honest, I have only heard one, besides the radio drama stations, I've only heard one book on audio, and that was Apocalypse from Fate of the Jedi. Mm. And that's because I didn't bring it with me on vacation. I brought the other five books. I read them in a whole week, and then I didn't have any more books to read. And so I just went ahead and just bought it on audio and listened to it on the way back up because I could not, you know, it was leaving me on a cliffhanger. I had to finish it.
Well, what do you think about the way that they use sound and sound effects?
You know, I loved it. I loved it. That was my first time to ever experience that. And I'd heard that they were good, but I always liked reading the book. But yeah, if they want to do a Dark Horse, Too Good to Be True bundle where $300 gets you all the audiobooks, I am there. I am there. No doubt about it. Have they done that to comic books? I want to say they have.
Comic books?
Haven't they done a...
audiobooks?
No, have they done an audio book for comic books? Audio.
They've adapted...
Dark Empire?
Dark Forces.
Okay, Dark Forces.
Crimson Empire, Dark Empire.
That's what I thought.
Those weren't comic books. But I think those are the only ones that they've done.
Like, okay, those...
They were done kind of like the radio dramas.
That's interesting, though. See, I would give those a shot, too. Maybe I did listen to Dark Empire.
I'm pretty sure you listened.
You had Dark Empire.
Yeah.
Yeah, you've had it for a while, too. So, no, I have listened to those, too. So, I don't know which one would be my favorite. Maybe Dark Empire. I mean, I can't remember them, but I think they're awesome. I think they're awesome on audiobooks. Next question he had was Twilight Zone or Outer Limits?
I would have to go with Twilight Zone just because I haven't really seen that many Outer Limits. But I was a fan throughout, you know, from the black and white into to the color versions they did in the later 80s, early 90s.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would have to go Twilight Zone 2 here, even though I think Outer Limits was just as good. In fact, we're going to talk about Twilight Zone, another podcast, and in it, I'm probably going to name an episode that I think is Twilight Zone that is actually Outer Limits, because it's very hard to discern which is which. For a while, I didn't keep track of what was what. In fact, I remember there was one episode I used to think was my favorite, and I found it was Outer Limits. it wasn't even a Twilight Zone. I was like, whoops.
That's very possible.
So they're both very good in their own right, yeah. To be honest. I just know there is one Twilight Zone episode that I can't wait to talk about because I still think it's one of the best ideas I've ever seen. So we'll talk about our favorite episodes of the Twilight Zone, which I think is a great question. We will talk about that in future episodes here. Next question, Eric Schroeder says that I talked about Calvin and Hobbes as a subject of one of my episodes. He's wondering if I've read any other comic strips like Dilbert or Garfield. Well, thank you, Eric. That was on Saturday Morning Samavlange. But we'll answer that question.
Being as they not even got to air this week.
No, I'm telling you what. Anyway, I haven't read... I mean, I used to read comic strips all the time as a kid. Calvin Hobbes is the only one I cared about. If I could care about another one, The Far Side, yeah. I thought was really great.
I go to every day, every weekend.
Was Family Circle. Or Family Circus. What's it called?
Family Circus. But, yeah, it was Calvin Hobbes and Farside. And I would occasionally read some of the others. But those are the only reasons I would pick up the comic strip pages in the newspaper were for Calvin Hobbes and Farside. And I would occasionally read the others. Once both of those stopped publishing, I haven't really picked up comic strips since.
Yeah, I read usually all the comic strips and didn't like them much. Every once in a while, this one would be fun, that one would be fun. And I'm not saying there's bad comic strips out there. I just haven't read any or tried out any new ones because Calvin Hobbes to me was perfect. I just really think it was. Garfield maybe had a funny one here and there, but I think a lot of them just got lazy and the comic strips just got stupid. And I hate that because I really like comic strips. And without Farside and Calvin Hobbes, I don't feel there's enough talented people out there. Like I said, I could be wrong because I haven't been looking into this. Set Fire to the Sky asks, top five memorable moments in the EU. Well, Set Fire to the Sky, I'm actually going to be talking about memorable moments in Matt's Expanded Universe, but I'll go ahead and let Bruce answer this one. Bruce, is there... You don't have to give me a top five. What's one that you just remember?
The use of the Rancors in the courtship of Princess Leia. I like the Wampas from Darksaber and the Death of Thrawn.
Ooh, out of all those three, My favorite one would probably be Darksaber. That Wampa scene was nice.
Read like a horror story.
I know. It was great. Yeah, before Dark Troopers, there was, you know, Darksaber. All right, he also asked, did we ever read Mark Hamill's Black Pearl series? And if so, what did we think? Guess what? We both read it. We both have it. We both own it. We both got it when it came out. Of course, anything with Mark Hamill's name, we were still fanboys. And this is at a time where Mark Hamill was trying to distance himself from being Luke Skywalker. He kind of dove into the comic book issues. So what did you think about Black Pearl, Bruce?
It was okay. I mean, it was nothing standout special or anything, but it was fun.
I thought it was, too. I thought it was nothing too special. It was okay. Is it worth buying? Yeah, if you can get it for cheap, it's interesting to read it.
I got my trade paperback off of eBay, three of them for like $5.
Okay. River of Black Lights asks, he wanted to ask if we've ever been to a Star Wars celebration. That would be no, we haven't. Never been. What do we think this new one's going to be like? Why aren't they supposed to release some very important information, like a new trailer?
They do every year.
At the celebration.
Important information that they never really do.
I don't know. Maybe you're right. Maybe they're just selling it again.
Coming out of the last few years that these celebrations have been kind of duds.
To be honest, I've checked out celebrations in the past, and the cast of people they have coming, none of them bring me in. Now, what do I mean by that? Because they're bringing in Mark Hamill, Carrie Fisher. They're bringing in big names. Notice how Harrison Ford is still not going to these functions.
He doesn't have to.
I know, but there is no one there that I don't already have their autograph, and the people who are there that I don't have their autograph, I can see at other cons very easily. So there's really no purpose, and there's never been any big reason for me to go to Celebration because Bruce is right. They always hype it up. And it ends up being nothing. Same old, same old.
I mean, there really could be some big news this year just because it is a movie year.
Right.
But, you know, when is Celebration? When is the dates on
it? It's in April.
It's in April. I guess they could release the trailer. I mean, there's been a lot of talk that the trailer will be attached to Avengers when it comes out. But, you know, April is just, you know, right before that. So I guess they could release the trailer if they felt like it. But, I mean, I'd catch that online.
Yeah, that's the question there, if they will or not. But you can get you online the next day, so it's really not that big a deal, I don't think. Now, for pro-EU people, yeah, there is a band. I think there's like 50-something people already committed to going from the Support the EU group. And that's great. We need a big presence there. But, of course, they need to be respectful. You know, don't rain on everyone's parade by wearing Disney Sucks T-shirts. You could get kicked out for that. But, you know, let your opinion be heard. When they have a book panel or whatever, make sure to ask the proper questions in a polite manner.
But, ask for more.
Yeah, just ask for more. Let them know that we are still out there and we're still asking. And we're nice about it. We're asking. But make sure they understand. We're not wanting to make it canon again. Bring it back to canon status or else we riot. No. We want them to continue it under the Legends banner. That's what we want now. They need to make sure they understand that. All right, next question. Alex Starr has a few questions here. He says, what Star Wars video games have you played? Which were your favorite? Alex, we answered this question actually a few episodes ago, so you may want to go back and check that out. Next one, do we plan on playing more games in the future, Star Wars or anything? I'm guessing he means video games by this. Yes, I plan on playing Arkham Knight. I don't know when, because I know you have to get a new system for that, or I can just get it from my computer here, which is what I may do. But I plan on playing it eventually. I just don't have time to play the extra video games. And I think all the other Star Wars games would be great, and to go back and get them would be fairly cheap. You can find a lot of the used ones or the bundles, the Humble Bundle they have out right now. I hear
it's over with.
Oh, it's over? Okay, well, that's fine.
I almost grabbed
it. But the thing is, though, I don't know because I just don't have enough time for video games right now. Bruce, do you play video games right now?
No.
I was thinking, cause, I mean, well, the reason I ask is Bruce has kids that are playing video games big time, so I didn't know. I know for a while he was playing some Zelda. Mm-hmm. Years ago, Bruce is a big Zelda fan.
Played Zelda through Twilight Princess, and I just haven't had time to pick up anything since.
Yeah, okay. All right, so another one, he says, do we like Monopoly? Yeah, sure. Who hates Monopoly?
Yeah, we like it. I have one son that's just obsessed with it. He loves it.
Monopoly is they're a very smart board game company. They know what keeps them relevant in today's culture. It's the number one selling board game for good reason. I haven't played it in years, but, you know, I know everyone knows how to play it. It's like playing chess. It's always going to be around. It's a fun game. And then also, top five Sith Lords. Bruce, go for it.
Really kind of obvious. We're going to have Darth Vader, Darth Plagueis, Darth Maul, Darth Bane, and Darth Krayt.
There you go.
And, you know, Darth, you know, the ones from the movies, Darth Bane, because, you know, I haven't read any of the Knights of the Old Republic books, so I'm not familiar with all the Sith Lords they have there. I'm not too familiar with Darth Krayt. I only read the first trade of the Legacy books, but I love his look. He looks fantastic, and I like who he turns out to be. You know, I thought that was a nice revelation there.
Okay, mine, I'm trying to put them in order as I think about it. Probably, it's easy to pick all the movie ones because we've seen them, we love them, we know them. And so I like all those picks. So I'll try to throw in, I think Darth Krayt's a good one to put in there because I do like him a lot. He probably gonna be number five. I'm going to put Lady Vader. You know, I just think, because she has a laser whip, man. It's so unique. Darth Vader would be up there. He'd be number three, though, because you know who I think would be better than, who is better than Darth Vader? Darth Cadus. You don't know who Darth Cadus is.
What's he from?
Spoiler alert, everyone. Skip a few seconds ahead. It's Jason Solo. Oh. Anyway, I just thought that his storyline was really good. So
ruined it for me.
There you go.
Live on air. Breaks.
You could have just plugged your ears. I'm trying to remind you.
Already ruined. They went bad.
Anyway, and then, of course, the number one is Darth Sidious. I think he's fantastic. Oh, wait. I got to somehow put Darth Plagueis in there, too, because he was really good, too. But anyway.
The book was good. Darth Plagueis really didn't do a whole lot in it. It was really Darth Sidious' story.
It really was, but that book
that was fantastic.
Made Darth Sidious even more. But even without that book, he would have been my number one. He's always been my number one, just because he's wheels within wheels, and such a complex character. And I'm sure that's a bunch of authors just laying one story over the other. But it makes sense, because that's who he is.
Yes.
You think Thrawn is smart? Imagine Thrawn with Sith ability. That's who Sidious is. You know, who would have won between Thrawn and the Emperor? The Emperor would have cleaned his clock. All right? And I'm not just talking about with Sith battles. I'm talking about, you know, outmaneuvering, outthinking, and everything. And I love Thrawn. I'm not trying to diss Thrawn or anything, but I think Sidious was just the ultimate Sith like that. I mean, he fooled the whole galaxy, for crying out loud. Yeah. Also, Alex Starr asked, how does he get a girl that's also interested in Star Wars to like him?
Good question.
Yeah, well, here's the deal, Alex. If they already like Star Wars, you're halfway there.
We don't know how to get one of those.
Yeah, get one that loves Star Wars. Wow, you can't fail at this point. But we gave some tips when Brian asked us this question. Brian C. asked us the question. I guess we can give more love advice,
yes.
Bruce. Okay. I would say don't be a Watto. Means don't be a creeper. Hello, pretty lady. No.
Work for me.
I knew it. She didn't mind you swatting flies, I mean, everywhere.
I did have to get rid of the flies.
Oh, okay. You did have to take a bath. Okay. Qui-Gon? Yeah, man. Smooth. That dude, he's smooth. He's a good listener. They love good listening. And then he enjoys the living force. So he just enjoys the simple things in life. So be happy. That's one thing. Don't be a Darth Vader, by the way. Don't, if you actually get to take her on a date and the waiter screws up, don't force choke him.
No.
Or real choke him. Don't try, I'm going to show her how big I am. What do you mean? You know, you're going to push your weight around.
And don't kill her in order to try to save her. Yeah, that's not a good thing either.
Yeah, don't do that either. Yeah, but don't show your anger out on your first date or second or probably third.
It's best just to keep that under wraps, period.
Yeah, you can kick a table or, you know, when you get home, but...
Only be angry for her.
When
she's mad.
Oh, yeah, when she's mad, you can be angry. But you can't be angry on your own. If, you know, if they spill Coke on you, don't freak out.
No.
Anyway, you need to be more like a Yoda. Have fun. Remember the first time we ever met Yoda in Empire Strikes Back? He is just basically screwing with Luke. I love it.
Yes.
He's like, oh, okay, he's going to think a great warrior. You know, I mean, this dude is... In fact, as a kid, I cracked up when I watched Empire Strikes Back because I thought, look, Yoda was so funny. And this is honestly one of the greatest Jedis to have lived at this point. So for him to act like a total fool and everything, he can look at the light side. And from the expanded universe, no spoilers here, but Yoda does have a funny past, or we're mentioned of it in, Courtship of Princess Leia?
Yes.
Yeah. So anyway, Yoda does have a fun little past, and be sure you can take yourself seriously, but also joke on yourself. It's totally cool. Don't be the, Debbie Downer who puts herself down every other sentence, but you can joke on yourself. That's funny.
My wife tells me I don't know anything about women, and so probably I'm not the best to answer these types of questions.
Well, I'm not either, but he just asked a question. I'm just trying to answer it. Anyway, okay, William once again talks about this and that, and he still doesn't believe me. But William, I don't think, to William's credit here, folks, I don't think he's met any of us. Now remember, he's coming in to someone who he knows is not a big supporter of Disney, and he's speaking his mind, which is fine. Very brave of you to come on in here, and that's fine. I enjoy that. But again, I don't think he's met anyone who has the different feelings than what he has. And vice versa, folks. I don't think you've met anyone like William. I don't think people give each other a shot. Again, to understand each other. The reason why Facebook, there's so much bickering on there and online and chat rooms and stuff, is because people want to focus on their differences when we should be focusing on the things we have in common. So just a little homework here, William. You said you're a big EU fan. I would love to hear your origin story, actually how you became a fan of the EU. Because that's one of the things, everyone who's talked to me before on Skype or whatever knows that's usually the first question I always ask is, okay, what's your origin story? How'd you get into the EU? And there's so many interesting ones. And I love hearing either one, every one of them. And I think I would make a bet that William probably has a pretty good one himself. So anyway, William, go ahead and put that in and definitely talk about that, because show the people here, I mean, you really do care about the EU. You're not just someone coming in here trying to just start up something.
But I would say this. I think he is right in that your baseball analogy is flawed.
Okay, how is it flawed?
I mean, just like I've heard some people who enjoy college sports or professional sports have put,
right.
R.C. Sproul Jr., he's known for saying that he's not a football fan. He's mm-hmm. a Pittsburgh Steelers fan. Just like you're not a Star Wars fan, you're a Star Wars original EU fan.
Okay.
Would that fit?
Yeah, I'm a Star Wars EU fan, yeah.
See, I can say I'm a Star Wars fan because I love it all. I absorb it all. Bring it all into my collective. But you drew the line.
Okay, so just to make sure, you're saying that you're better than the other people who call themselves Star Wars fans. Just to make sure. That's sounding elitist.
I'm just better than you.
Oh, okay. All right. There you go. So there you heard it from Bruce
I've been
there.
I've been telling you this for a long time.
All right. There you go.
Just need to learn to accept it.
Okay. I'm not gonna defend one single comment that we have for next week. All right, so Troy Patterson says,
release your hate.
He said, he's not against Han dying, but he doesn't want it done too early. Because if he dies in episode 7, he can't be around for any of the off stories or before episode 8. Is it too early? Would it be too early to kill off Han, in your opinion?
I would say, when you stop and look at the first two trilogies, what happens? A main character is killed off in the first part of every story. You had Obi-Wan in the original. You had Qui-Gon in the prequels. There's always the tragedy that spurs on the rest of it. And Han is the perfect character. You have the big character carried over from previous. Just like Obi-Wan from the prequels. He died in the original. Now you have Han carried over. He dies in the first one. And that instigates the events that follow.
Good. I understand where you're coming from with that. I understand where you're coming from. Someone always dies. But the thing is, though, this is a returning character. Mm-hmm. This isn't a character. No, when we saw episode 4 for the first time, that was his first time we'd seen him.
But you can't look there at it that thing.
Way. No, I am. You can look at it that way. And you can look at Qui-Gon. We didn't have... What if they make an episode 0 where we get to see more Qui-Gon?
Qui-Gon story,
it doesn't add to the death there because we already know he died. But the thing is, though, this one would be a little different because this is someone that everyone knows. They've been watching him for 3 movies. And now... He's going to die? Another question someone had was, are you really serious when you said you're looking forward to a Marvel superhero Star Wars crossover, Bruce?
Yes, I am. I mean, really, I truly am deeply excited for when this will happen. This will happen. I just know it will. And I'm very much excited to see, you know, really, it's the age-old question. What would win in a battle, the lightsaber or adamantium? Will Captain America's shield block a lightsaber? Will Wolverine's claws block the lightsaber?
This is
this has been an age-old question. People have been.
It's just a fanboy question. You don't really need to answer it. I don't think crossovers justify anything.
Crossovers answer everything. Everything that all the
that Batman's better than Hulk.
What? Never happened. Never.
See? Exactly. This coming from a guy who thinks he's better than you from watching Disney Star Wars.
Come on, you saw the Batman versus Darth Vader YouTube video. I mean, that was awesome.
Oh my goodness! Yeah, for fan projects, it's fun, but I don't want any official stuff because then that would be canon, right?
Yes, it would be canon.
It would be canon.
Official canon.
Yeah, there's your Disney canon. Disney canon would include all of Marvel comic books and DC because they cross over with DC, and then it opens Pandora's box.
I know it's a great box to open.
Oh my goodness! You just want total anarchy. That's all you're looking for, aren't you? Total anarchy here. Okay, a few other questions here by Edward. One, he says, do we ever cosplay? No, Edward. No. Don't cosplay. I think some cosplay is amazing, and when I go to the cons, I am always in awe at some of the cosplay artists. Cosplaying is not for me. I couldn't make, you know, two sheets look like a ghost. I
do
it just terrible.
But that's about the only time of year that I really get around to it.
No, you wear that mask on your face. Oh. Anyway, no, we do not cosplay. Next question Edward asks is about Luke Skywalker himself, his story arc from, you know, farm boy to grandmaster. Do we think that was done well? Anything we dislike about that? Bruce?
Overall, it was done well. I thought there was a few slumps in the storytelling around the time of Planet of Twilight. Really, the Callista stuff, I was just not a fan of Callista. I did not like that relationship. I did not like her. And I thought it was a time when Luke was kind of scared of the Force, it seemed like, in the story. But, you know, they corrected that. They went the right way, and they turned him into a very, very, very powerful Jedi.
Yeah, I actually love the story. I love Luke's story. There are some personality traits I don't like about Luke Skywalker, but I like that the character has those traits.
Yes.
You can't be a perfect character. You know, perfect characters who can do no wrong, who outthink everyone, who are more powerful than everyone. That's a boring character. Hello, Superman. I'm looking right at you. It's a boring character. That's why Superman's not that entertaining to me.
Superman can be a good character. It really depends on the writers they have at the time. But yeah, Superman is flawed in that he doesn't have good writers that understand a perfect character. I like the idea of a perfect character, but it is really, really hard to execute.
Yeah. Well, that is a debate for another time when we talk about comic books in the near, near future, obviously. Another thing is, I forgot to mention, we are not on SoundCloud.
What?
Yeah.
You lied to us.
Yeah. Two episodes got on, and then they want to charge us $80 for the next four. I was like, then $80 for four more, and then $80 for four more. I was like, no.
I wonder. See, I saw that there were several, and then I saw that a couple went away. So I guess.
Yeah, they took them off. It was kind of weird because I questioned them. I said, well, why? I can't post them. I can't rotate. No. Muffin Man asked, do we own any books with the Legends banner on it? Bruce?
I do not.
I don't either. That's because I got them all when they came out originally. Am I against the Legends banner? Nope. I'm all for the Legends banner.
And you need to start supporting the Legends banner, though, by actually, you know, with your money.
Yeah.
If you want to come back, you need to support it financially.
Yeah.
Go out and buy those Legends.
I already have them all. If they bring out a new book under the Legends banner, sold. Sold all day. I don't care about the Legends banner. I'm fine with it. Relic asks, if we could meet one Star Wars author, who would we want to talk to?
Well, see, Matt doesn't have very many left on that list. in fact, all the Star Wars author autographs I have on my novels, Matt has picked up for me.
Right.
Just about. I think I got Kevin J's by myself. But I've not met Timothy Zahn, and I would like to, you know, he'd be one that I would like to admit.
Timothy Zahn, yeah. Yeah, definitely. I haven't met them all. I have met a lot of them. I've spoken to a lot of them. The only one I have not met or spoken to that I really would is Troy Denning.
Yes.
Troy Denning would be high up there on my list because I would love to pick that man's brain and what he had. He was kind of the head of the New Republic era, that entering the legacy era of the book and the storyline. So he would have the most knowledge on where it was going.
Yeah.
Now, how much of that information would he be free to give up? Zero.
And you hope that they might pick it back up again. So,
but too much right now. But I would love to meet him because I do think he's an amazing author. Now, if I was to cheat on this one, because I did think about cheating and answering and saying Pablo Hidalgo, because he's written some stuff, and I just want to talk to him about the EU. And let's get something together, man. Come on. And I want to pick his brain. That's cheating. So let's go with a regular author, and Troy Denning would definitely be at top of my list right now. Troy Patterson again asks, which book have you read the most? Bruce, which book have you read the most? Star Wars book.
I think we've covered this like every podcast almost. The Empire is one I've actually
read the most. The most.
And really it's because I've only actually physically read it once. I've read the comic book adaptation.
The audiobook.
For a while, it was the only unabridged Star Wars book they had out in audio cassette. And I had that. I've read the abridged, or listened to the abridged, read by Anthony Daniels. Very nice. He was a good reader. I wish they would get him for some of the unabridged books. And then they recently came out with Audible editions of the unabridged version. So I've read them. That as well.
Yeah, Troy, I'm going to have to cheat on this. I mean, I've read a few of the books twice, but I started thinking about which book have I read the most. It's actually going to be a Westing Games adventure one. It's the Darkstrider campaign. The introduction is written by Timothy Zahn, and I have read that a couple of times, but I just think that story, the actual adventure in it is so interesting. It pulls me. It intrigues me, and I've read about 4 or 5 times now, and actually was thinking about doing it again just because it just intrigues me, that adventure novel does. If we did role play, that would be definitely one of the games I'd like to play because it's so interesting. But anyway, one of the things with Troy, I actually got to talk to Troy on Skype not too long ago, and he showed me where, did you know this? Pablo Hidalgo had released some commentaries for the original trilogies where he gives commentary about, you know, all the EU behind-the-scenes facts. Like, when we first saw that robot, what happened to that person? According to the card game, this is who this person is, and so on and so on and so forth. Now, the only thing is, when they reformatted the website, they took all those commentaries down. Mm-hmm. Troy got the first one, A New Hope, but he's looking for Empire and Jedi. And I got to be honest, folks, I would like to hear these too. Those would be incredibly fun. So if you know or have the Pablo Hidalgo commentaries tracks for Empire and Jedi, please let us know in the comments. You can type in the comments here or just reply to Troy's message from last week's podcast. Anyway, so moving on to our last question. Bardane says, I shared my love of Calvin Hobbes in Saturday Morning Santa Flange. And we did talk about Bone, the comic book. And he says, but what about European classic comics like Asterix, Tintin, or Lucky Luke? Bruce, have you read any of those?
I have not.
No, I haven't either. Tintin's familiar with us because they made the movie. I actually looked these up. Bardane, you gave away your nationality. I think they're interesting. Lucky Luke actually had a cartoon, I think, back in the 60s or 70s. So
the Adventures of Tintin movie, which
these are books that I did go to the store, Bardane, and look at them. The thing is, though, I would love to see one here in our bookstores, and we don't have them, only because I want to look through them myself first before buying it. No offense, I'm sure they probably are real good, but I'd like to see for myself, like a little sample first, and try them out. I was able to read a few English translated ones that looked fun, but I want to know more about them. But yeah, I would always be interested in more comic strips. In fact, I think Bardane's channel is focused on a lot of that, because that's where I found some of the YouTube videos I found out. So Bardane, I thought they were pretty good. They were very educational. Some of them I couldn't understand because they were in French. Bardane, I want to tell you something. I actually got kicked out of high school French. That's a story we'll save for another day, but I actually got kicked out of my French class in high school once. So,
and really, outside of American comic books, I've read a handful of manga that I've really enjoyed, a few that I reread semi-regularly just because I enjoy them so much. But for the most part, we're American comic fans.
Now, there's a few things we wanted to talk about. First, we need to mention the passing away of a classic, Leonard Nimoy, who played Spock in Star Trek.
Yeah, so sad.
It was sad. I remember when he was going to the hospital and everyone was sending well wishes, and I didn't think he was that bad off. I thought he had a touch of pneumonia. He was going to get over it. I knew he was in bad health. He's been in bad health for a while.
He looked pretty bad in the last Star Trek.
Yeah, but the thing was, his health had been sliding down. There was nothing he could do to stop it.
I was going to say, you know, this has made me more thankful that he was in that last Star Trek movie.
I wish it kind of wasn't.
No, I'm glad he sucked. Was. It's the last time you'll see him.
Anyway, though, well, I would have liked to remember him from Star Trek 1. Bigger role, a little bit better. Anyway, regardless, though, he was a good guy. We're both Star Wars fans, but, of course, I have a huge affinity to Star Trek. I love him. I do like Star Trek. I have a lot of appreciation for it. We can talk about Star Trek sometime in the future episodes. But, of course, Leonard Nimoy's portrayal of Spock is just pure genius.
It's classic.
And, honestly, the best scene. You want to talk about the best scene for Spock? It's definitely got to be Wrath of Khan. The moment he dies behind the glass in his speech to Captain Kirk was super sad. I mean, I was just... My brain broke at that scene. I didn't know what to do. I was just like... He's dead for good. I mean, this is just awful. I mean, just so many emotions running through. And supposedly, in the movie theater, when Leonard Nimoy saw the actual film, he cried.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a powerful scene, though.
And you know what?
That's why when they ripped it off and entered darkness, it just made me so mad.
You know what?
What?
If they would have held off, they would not have been able to redo that scene. If you think if they would have made the new Star Trek II after the death of Leonard Nimoy, I bet you they wouldn't have touched that scene.
You don't think so?
Yeah, everybody's been posting the funeral scene of Spock on Facebook and social media all week. And I don't think the audiences would have accepted it. I mean, nobody accepted it to begin with the sequel to the J.J. Abrams Star Trek. But to really, at this point now, I think they would have had riots if they would have tried to change that scene.
Yeah. Oh man, it's a fantastic scene in Wrath of Khan. I think that's a brilliant movie. Anyway, so we are sad to see him go.
Yes,
do love us some Spock. So may the Force be with him.
Oh, and on Audible, I would recommend the Star Trek Spock versus Q.
Yes.
Of them two just kind of going at each other. They're very fun.
It's Spock meets Q, right? And they start having a debate.
And I think it's Spock versus Q.
Oh, it's fantastic. It's a battle of the minds, though, yes. Folks. He's not fighting him.
And really, it was an on-stage performance that they
But it's did. Brilliantly carried. And by the way, John DeLance is also incredibly awesome.
Yeah, he's a lot of fun.
He is a whole lot of fun. Okay, another thing we wanted to talk about. The Power Ranger movie that's online, the R-rated
Power/Ranger
14-minute film. What did you think of Power/Ranger?
I thought it was a lot of fun.
It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was nice to see Katie Stackhoff and that guy from Dawson's Creek. You know,
James Vanderbeek.
Whatever his name is.
Just because he never played the Hulk, you don't even bother remember his name. But yeah, no, I thought it was really good. It was a little dark. I was actually surprised. I know they said, oh, it's dark. I went, you know, whatever. I was like, oh, it's kind of dark.
Yeah.
But it's actually done really well. I don't know who this guy is and how he got these connections.
Did they got behind the Punisher Dirty Laundry short movie.
How does he get these actors to do this? Well, I know how he got Thomas Jane to do it, but how does he get the actors into it? By the way, if you have not seen Punisher Dirty Laundry, that is well worth your time.
Yes.
That is well worth your time. It's on the YouTubes, and it's actually very good. So, yeah, Power Ranger, would you recommend it?
Yes, I do recommend it. And, you know, after the controversy, you know, Saban had it pulled down for a few days. They did come to some agreement where they had to, you know, label it as, you know, not for kids. But yeah, I'm glad it is, you know, back released.
Well, one of the things I did this weekend, actually, is I went to Pensacon in Pensacola, Florida, and I kind of wanted to give my Pensacon review. Got to meet a lot of fun people at Pensacon. One of them was Felix Sela. He played one of the Ewoks in Return of the Jedi and was also in the Ewok movies. He was, I think, Weechi, Wicked's older brother, and who fought a lot and called his other brother Lurdos.
So you were two-timing Yub Nub? No. All by himself.
What are you talking about? I got that for Yub Nub. Yub Nub's so excited to see a familiar face again. He's so happy. But I'll be honest, Felix Sela, for anyone who hasn't met him, he was also the Kitty Droid in the original Battlestar Galactica. I don't know the name of it. I never saw the original Battlestar Galactica, to be honest. Anyway, but he is a really energetic guy, really fun, really upbeat. Laughs, runs around, talks to other people when no one's at his booth. I mean, he's not sitting there sad or depressed or, you know, kind of lonely like some people are. He is just all excited. You come up to him, talk to him, he'll start talking, laughing with you. He's just a really fun guy. The other guy I got to meet was Carl Strucken, and he actually played Tarok in the Ewoks Battle for Endor, which I love the Ewoks movies. I do. I love them all, and he plays the main villain who used to scare the bejesus out of me when I was a kid. I mean, just because of the makeup alone on that dude.
Yeah, pretty good.
And he was awesome. Now, I asked him about the making of, because I'm interested, because there's no making of the videos. And he said, of course, it took him hours and hours to get the makeup on, but even the suit is many different complex layers, he said. And the thing that was most difficult about acting, I said, well, it looks heavy. He said, oh, that wasn't the bad part. He said the bad part was they were filming it in the middle of the summer. So how many Ewoks, that's what I want to ask, is how many Ewoks passed out? What were they thinking? I mean, yeah, we're talking California, so what, high 70s? But still, the same thing, though. You're wearing all that makeup. You're wearing all that armor and stuff. I mean, you're going to start cooking.
It's going to be miserable.
And he said he was miserable during it. I mean, he enjoyed doing it. He loved doing it. In fact, when I first asked for him to sign that one, because he also played Lurch from the Addams Family, the newer movies, the 90s movies. And he had a bunch of Lurch stuff out there. He had some Star Trek stuff because he played a character in Star Trek. But he had only one Terra. And I was like, oh, he has it. So that's why I got his autograph. He went, do you know who this is? I went, yes, it's Tarek from Battle of the Endor. Duh. You know. But I don't think anyone asked for that one from him. So he doesn't get many requests for that one. But he was very happy to tell me about it. By the way, I can't show you the size of this man's head, but take two of your heads together, maybe three of your heads together, and put them together. Seriously, this guy has a huge skull. And not to be gross, but when he dies, I want his skull. They got to dedicate that to science. He has the biggest head I've ever seen. The dude's about 7 feet tall, maybe even taller. I mean, he is Peter Mayhew size, if anyone's seen him. Peter Mayhew, when he's sitting down, he is almost your height sitting down. And so is this guy. His head alone is 2 feet. I don't know. But, I mean, he's got a huge head. Anyway, but he is an incredibly nice guy. Got me an autograph. So happy about it. And then, of course, the third autograph that I added to my Star Wars collection is one of my favorites. General Veers himself, Julian Glover. And Julian Glover also, for folks who want to get a better idea of who he was the main villain in Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. And by the way, he was a brilliant villain in the Indiana Jones. That's why Last Crusade, would that be added to your favorite? Why it's your favorite?
Oh, yeah.
He is so good in that movie, and he's so good in anything he touches. Super nice guy. The only celebrity there that did not charge for his photo.
Really?
The only one there.
Why
did not
give me one?
It was totally... Well, you going to come over there and pose with him? I'm not going to take a picture of him. That's weird. Man's like 80-something. You don't take pictures alone with him. Anyway, no, I took a picture with him. Super nice guy. Very, very British. Gave me a Cheerio.
Oh.
He's like, okay, Matt, Cheerio. I was like, yeah, Cheerio. You know, but I mean...
What does that even mean?
Yeah, no, but seriously, super nice guy. Loves working with George. Oh, speaking of George... Carl Strucken said that George Lucas visited the set, you know, every day, check on the crew, check on the cast, see how things were going, see what they needed, kind of see what they were shooting today, and then he'd walk off. He wasn't there totally hands-on the whole time, just about what he was like for Clone Wars. You know, he was on, checking in, Here's some, gave a few ideas, walked out. It was in his backyard. They filmed this on Skywalker Ranch, by the way. Both Ewok movies were. And so he said Skywalker Ranch is amazing. It's this huge outside. He said it's just beautiful, just land that George owns. And he just walked onto the set every day and just says hello. What's going on? What you got going on today? Okay, you got something? Okay. If they ask for his opinion, he's giving ideas here and there. Then he goes off. It's like he went back to his house. Okay, I'm going home. Y'all keep filming.
With the prequels.
I'll be bringing out cookies and lemonade later on. Yeah, why couldn't this happen to the prequels? What was he thinking? Oh, there's a question. Are the Ewok movies better than the prequels?
I'm going to save this for another day.
Oh, boy. No, you know what, though? George did write the Ewok movies, and they weren't bad.
No, I think he's a good story creator.
Mm-hmm.
He's just not a good storyteller.
Right. All right, so, and you know what? That reminds me that there was a guy, I actually talked to a hater that gave me the whole George Lucas Starlog quote that he didn't care. I said, well, you forgot, as always, to copy what Leland Chee says, that many people, you know, misunderstand that saying. They misquote it, and blah, 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 blah. Here's what he meant. I said, but I see you left that out, too. And then I asked him the question about, well, if they're throwing George's stuff out, George doesn't consider anything Episode 7 or anything Disney's doing canon because it's not George-approved. They're not using any of his ideas, too. He said
Matt
that.
And George share the same canon.
It's funny. They want to hold George as the standard for establishing canon when it fits their purpose. When it goes to, tell me, to Disney, whatever the company decides. Okay, well, the company, Lucasfilm, decided it was canon. And then, of course, you know, well, that was the end of his conversation there. Kind of tied him down there. So, you know, they want to hide behind Lucas for that reason. And by the way, it's always been what the company considers canon. Disney says that the new stuff coming out is canon. So right now it's canon. All that stuff's canon. Yeah. I've never argued that fact. I've never even argued the right that Disney had. What right do they have? How dare they? No, it's their business. They bought it. They can do whatever they want with it. So if they want to say, nope, this is the new canon. Okay, that's the new canon. Speaking of the new canon, Bruce.
Yes.
How is Darth Vader?
Oh, the Darth Vader comic book series from Marvel Comics. I'm assuming that's what you're asking about?
Yeah.
Okay, issue 1 came out a few weeks ago. Issue 2 came out this last week. Haven't read issue 2 yet, but I did enjoy the first issue a lot. It picks up right where Darth Vader left off from issue 2 of the Star Wars ongoing series. After his failure to stop the rebels from blowing up that base, the Emperor chastises him and puts him under the command of another Moff Tarkin type person. Now Darth Vader's got his own plan that he wants to work on the side because he wants to find out who this Jedi was that blew up. Well, this Force-sensitive person that blew up the Death Star.
So this is Vader's quest all over again?
Yeah, so he goes to Tatooine, meets with Jabba the Hutt. Very nice scene. I did enjoy it. He just walks in and tells Jabba what Jabba's going to do, and Jabba has to do it. Didn't want to, but he did. But it leads to the first meeting between Boba Fett and Darth Vader. And I thought it was a really nice ending. You know, Boba Fett comes to meet him. You see Darth Vader standing there. He tells him what he wants, and then pans out, and Darth Vader's in the middle of a Tusken Raider village, and everyone is slaughtered. Like, hey, I'm on Tatooine. I'm going to go slaughter a Tusken Raider village while I'm here. I thought that was a nice little touch in the end.
Okay, now there's another thing that we wanted to talk about. Has anyone seen the cover to Darth Vader 2?
Yes, very fabulous cover.
Bruce did. Bruce just showed me the cover prior to us going live, and I have some questions.
Strutting down the runway with the wind blowing through his cape.
Hmm.
There was a model's runway, but...
Darth Vader is looking a little fabulous in that photo. What is Disney saying about our Dark Lord of the Sith there? I'm a pretty princess. Sing that song while you look at the cover, folks. I'm a pretty princess. Okay, so, by the way, Heir to the Jedi cover, he's walking the skies, isn't it? He's looking fabulous, too, like father, like son.
I haven't seen it, so I can't comment.
Well, I can't wait till Princess Leia 2 comes out. She'll look like a man.
Well, the Princess Leia cover had Darth Vader and Luke on it, so I'm not quite sure where they're going there.
Anyway, okay, so another person that I got to meet was Dave Dorman. And as you know, Bruce and I think have talked about Dave Dorman. His art is incredible. This man is incredible. I got several of his little art cards autographed by him. I got my Dark Empire one trade paperback because I didn't want to bring the comic books. I brought the trade paperback with him, and he signed that one. He even drew a little picture for me. I even picked up Bruce some of his sketchbooks.
Yes.
And the sketchbook is it's got just little sketches from different designs and covers he's done. And he drew Bruce a little Mandalorian inside them.
Very nice.
So, yeah, he is a super nice guy, folks. I don't know when you'll get to meet him because this is the first one I have ever seen him at. In fact, he was the reason I was excited to go.
Yes.
So meeting Dave Dorman was all that it was cracked up to be. The man is, first off, he's a gentleman. He's very respectful. He has nothing but good things to say about the people in the business. I mean, genuinely good things. I mean, not just some guy trying to be nice to people. He really appreciates good artists and good writing and good story. And we talked a little bit about how Dark Empire just works on all levels. And then I asked him the question, what comic books does he read now? He gave it some thought. He doesn't want to offend anyone in the industry, but he thinks that superhero comic books have kind of lost a step here and there. He mentioned the story. He mentioned art. No, he did not mention titles, and I'm not going to make him, because he actually works in the business. So that would be unprofessional to throw someone under the bus. So I didn't even bother asking. But he was kind enough to say, admit that he doesn't read a lot of that. He likes the non-superhero stuff. I said, what gets you interested in the book? The story? That he said, well, the art. And he thinks the art's been lacking too. Art and story lacking in superhero comic books. And the direction, actually, is what he said in general, just wasn't what it used to be. And I have to agree with that. And Bruce, you wanted to say something on this.
Yeah, I mean, it's one thing I've noticed. When if you pick up an old comic book and compare it to a new comic book, you know, the newer pages do stand out just on a cursory glance. But I think it's all because the modern coloring process is so much better. I've seen where they've taken some of these old comic books and recolored them with the modern techniques, and they blow all the modern stuff out of the water. I mean, Dark Horse put out a line of the 70s Conan, the Barbarian comic books, with new colors. Dynamite did the same thing with some Red Sonja. I've seen some pages of old Jack Kirby Fantastic Four recolored. I'm telling you, when you put them on the same playing field with the modern colors, the old stuff just kills modern art.
It really
is amazing. It's not something that I saw coming before.
I would agree. Even in the heyday of the 90s when I was collecting and everything, you could see great artists, but then they just slowly went away, and the people replacing that people liked were either just awful copycats or they didn't have their own unique design.
And really, I don't think the people that we thought when we were kids in the 90s
were as good as those back in the 60s. Hey, you could be right on that, yeah.
Some of Spawn. I mean, I remember holding Spawn books. I was like, oh, man, this stuff is awesome. Going back, there's nothing special about it. I mean, it's good. There's nothing stand out. It's not what I thought it was when I first saw it. But
now, what do you think about stories? Because, I do not keep up with what comic books are doing right now. I know they made the Falcon Captain America, right, or something. They made Thor a woman. They've done a few things, and to me, honestly, when I hear something like that, that is a cheap ploy to sell comic books.
It is.
Is what it is. It's like when they do Superman. The reason I just get pissed off at Superman for so long is because the writing there sucks. Remember Blue Superman? He's a blue ball of energy or something, and this is the way he's going to stay forever, kids.
Never take forever.
No, because then they did Red Superman, then you had two Superman, then they say, oh, this is kind of getting cheesy, and then they stopped it, and then gave him a mullet. I mean, it makes no sense. And it's just for, you know, giggles there. They just throw some stupid story in there. Like Catwoman, what they've done to her lately.
It's always something, whatever, to just spark news.
How does making her bi add anything to the storyline? How does that add anything to her character storyline? It's something that you really don't need to know. It's like establishing Batman as a Yankees fan. Why do we need to know that? How is that going to benefit the story there?
Comic books have become too politically sensitive these days. You know, it used to be they would just tell the story. I mean, if you go back and read old X-Men comic books with Northstar, if you go back and read them, it's obvious he was gay in those comic books. But
it was it really?
Yes. If you go back and read it, it's obvious. But
you're like the only person who read Alpha Flight back in the day.
I was reading Alpha Flight back in the day.
So is that why? I thought they just made him gay just to sell his comic book.
No, well, actually, they announced it and they had a big to do and had to, it got him on the news and put a spike in sales. And that's all it was. The announcement, that's all it was to spike the sales. And
well, they gave his own little miniseries, right?
I don't know if he's ever had his own miniseries.
He did shortly after that.
Everybody in the 90s had their own miniseries, I guess.
Right, he had his own miniseries going on.
But I think it was Michelle Rodriguez from the Fast and Furious movies.
Mm-hmm.
She even came out earlier this week. There were talk of her being Green Lantern. And she
should. Why?
I know. She came out with that. She was like, why are they changing race and sex on these characters?
Yeah.
She came out, and I agree with her, that it's just, they're only doing it for publicity. It's a stunt. Yeah. It's pointless. I mean, it's not a story. If you want a good character, make a good character. Don't just change old characters to the way you want them to be so that, you know, you can put a 30-second news blip on CNN or whatever.
Anyway, did you hear about Spider-Man? Probably not going to be Peter Parker, they said. Almost for sure not going to be Peter Parker.
I don't know how they're going to pull that off.
Is this a mistake?
It is a mistake to not go with Peter first. I mean, I think they need to bring Miles Morales into it. I think that'd be fantastic.
But not as Peter, and not really, as Spider-Man.
I think they ought to just bring Spider-Man into the guest appearances on The Avengers and Captain America, and then the next Spider-Man movie proper be Miles Morales. But without Peter Parker, I don't know how they're going to do Miles.
Hmm.
And I don't know how the general public is going to understand it.
Only the shadow knows. All right, folks, that's all the time we have for today. We'll see you next time on Princes of the Universe.